Welcome. It's lovely to see you all here today. Our webinar is Planning the School Year Around Cambridge English Qualifications. So, my name's Miranda Hamilton.
And I'm Donya Estafanous. So the aim today is really to raise awareness of all of the exam support throughout the school year, which we have on our website, okay? So our website will help you to prepare and plan ahead for the year, to engage parents so they can support their children, so you can feel confident about preparing learners for exams, and also to encourage teachers and schools to celebrate exam success. Now, in order to achieve our aims, we're going to be talking you through the way our website is designed to support you through each stage of the year. Now, you'll notice we have indicated the link at the top of the screen. Okay, let's take a closer look. Let's start by following the link and taking a look at the first page of the website. The part of the screen that we're interested in today is information for preparation centres. So let's take a close look. We're going to be talking you through the way our website's designed to support you through each stage of the year. And we'll be focusing on each part of the website shown on the right-hand side of the screen. Please do ask any questions that you have as we go along. We'll try to answer them as we go along, won't we?
Yes.
But if not, there's also a section at the end purely for Q&A, so we'll try to answer them then. All right. Now, you can find the different sections that we're talking about by following the link that we're going to show you at the top of each screen. And it's important just to know that at the end of the webinar, you will be sent the slides, so you'll have a record of the links and know exactly which part of the website to navigate to.
Okay.
Okay, so let's begin with the start of the year.
Okay, so it's the start of the year. Now, we know that depending on where you are in the world, it may not be your start of the year. But don't worry, this will still be helpful for you because there's lots of information that will take you stage by stage through the year. However, for others, it is the start of the year. So, here we are. Here's the link at the top of the website. You can see that the part that we're focusing on is that start of the year. Now, the start of the year is exciting. It's full of hope and promise, and it's a great opportunity for you to hold an event in school. But again, at the start of the year, it's a lot of work. It's a really busy time for all teachers after the holiday. You've got new students to get to know, you've got new classes, timetables to plan, and students to find out about. But don't worry, we're here to help. Now, if you look at the website, you can see that there's an events toolkit, and you can download the materials from there, which will give you plenty of ideas if you wish to hold an event. So let's take a look at where everything is and what we have available. So follow the link and you can see, start of the year, we have available for you a presentation for parents, which means that you can download that presentation so that you don't need to prepare it for yourselves. But we also have an events toolkit, which you can go into and find a wealth of lovely resources. Now, I've got a little question for you, and I'm wondering how often your school runs an event for parents. Also, when do they run an event for parents? So think about those two questions. How often do you run events for parents, and when? Type it into the text box.
Mm.
Let's take a look, Donya.
Let's have a look. There might be a slight delay, so we'll just wait for those to come in.
It's always a really helpful thing to do, though, isn't it? Because parents have got lots of questions at the beginning of the year.
Absolutely. Parents want to know what it is their students are learning and what they're aiming towards.
Yeah, and what to expect.
Exactly.
So have we got any
answers
here?
Oh, okay. So some people say, we never run an event.
And yet somebody else has said once a month, which is really regular.
Wow, once a term, that's really nice.
Yeah.
That's a good opportunity, isn't it, to meet parents and let them know what, you know, the aims for the term.
Yes, yes.
We don't do any... once a year at the end of the year.
Rather than the beginning. So we're going to talk about how in which you might be able to talk to parents at the beginning of the year to encourage them and motivate them and give them confidence about how they can support their child. Let's take a closer look. So, if you go into downloading the event toolkit, you will find so many lovely resources that will help you. So that helps your planning. After all, we know that teachers are extremely busy and the last thing you want to do is have to start from scratch. So what have we got for you? We have event guides, which will help you with your planning. We have event invitation templates, so you can really welcome your parents by sending out a lovely professional looking invitation. We also have activity booklets for parents. So this is something that you can distribute at your evenings, parents' meetings. And there are event posters that you can put up in the venue so that parents know that they're in the right place. And there are parents' take-home leaflets. Now, these are really helpful because after all, a lot of information is given out at parents' meetings, and sometimes they can go home and think, I'm not sure I can quite remember everything that was said. So that's very, very helpful. It's a summary of the sorts of things that you might discuss. Now, I want us to take a look, first of all, at the events guide. Now, the events guide is a terrific little resource pack because it provides you with some really helpful ideas to think about when planning the event. Not giving the event, but the planning and the organisation. So, for example, it's really important to think about your audience. Who are you inviting? Is it your parents? There might be some learners there as well, so you may need to adapt so that it's relevant for them. It's also helpful to think about the topics that you're going to cover and the materials you're going to need for the event, what handouts you might need. May you need to have to print off a lot of things. Let's take a look at the next page of the events guide. So, it will also give you tips on planning ahead, thinking really carefully about where the event's going to take place and when the event is going to happen. So I think it would be helpful to take a look at this in a little more with a little more detail. Looking more carefully about where the event is going to take place, something that I know I have found really, really very helpful as a teacher is thinking about the space that I'm going to need. How much space will you need? Well, of course, if you send out the invitations, you may have a good idea about your numbers. So that will help you to think about your seating, your layout. If you've got a lot of people there, it may be that you want it in sort of conference style. If it's a small gathering, there may be a horseshoe style in a small circle. But there are a wealth of tips and ideas to help you plan your event within the guide. One of the things that we know that parents always ask is how they can help their child. Mm-hmm. But we've thought of this, and we've got some ideas for the parents to take away. And I want to take a closer look at this, because this is something that you can reassure parents with a take-home booklet. Now, this is an activity booklet that you can give out at the end of the meeting. You can demonstrate from during the meeting if you wish. And we have activity booklets, for younger learners. You can see on the left-hand side with our monkey there, that's for our younger learners. And on the right-hand side for our older learners, and all of these booklets offer parents the opportunity to help their child practice their English at home. Obviously, The ideas in the younger learners are designed specifically for their needs, whereas they're adapted slightly for the older learners. So, for example, I'm going to show you some ideas that, just a selection, there are more within the booklet, of ideas that parents can do with their children at home to help them build on the skills that they're working on in school, but to practice with at home. For example, we offer ideas on how parents can help their child with reading. Here's a little example. Encourage the child to read English language books with interesting pictures and topics. And we all know the value of these sorts of books with lovely, colourful pictures. In terms of writing, it's really lovely, and children love to do this as well. Encourage children to draw pictures and posters with their parents at home and ask them to attach written labels and descriptions. Perhaps build on the topics that they've been working on in class to practice the vocabulary. That's a lovely idea, and this is something that parents will enjoy and be able to participate in with their child. But what about listening? Now, something that, with the advent of the internet, of course, it's possible to watch English language TV shows by turning off the volume, and then the child can, with the parent, can guess what the people are saying and perhaps try to practice some vocabulary or language that would work with that TV show as they're following it. And then listen whether or not they've got any of those ideas correctly. And what about speaking? Again, it's a lovely thing to find a cartoon strip and ask the child to look at the pictures and to retell the story with their child. Now, I'm just wondering whether or not there are any comments here coming in from anybody about this, these ideas.
There was a question about parents not being able to speak English. Mm-hmm. So, if parents can't speak English, how can we present to them in English? But actually, we're not saying that the presentations have to be done in English. We supply the materials and they can, of course, be adapted. And in your context, if it's more appropriate to deliver the presentation in the local language in that L1, then that's absolutely fine, isn't it?
Yes, yes. And the slides are designed to help you to do just that. Mm. Shall we take a look at the next slide? We've got another question.
One more thing. A few of you have said, what do we do about parents who can't support their students with their children with these activities, again, because of the language issue? What if they're not motivated or that they can't speak the language? But I think, again, it's worth pointing out that the parents don't have to have a really good level of English. No. They just need to support their child and encourage them, let them watch English television, let them read in English, even if they don't understand it. The most important thing is to be encouraging and supportive.
I agree with that. I definitely agree with that. I think sometimes it's really lovely when your child is practicing something new to celebrate with them and think, this is wonderful, I can't speak English, but look at you and how well you're doing, practicing the language that they're doing at school. So we're blurring the boundary between what they're doing in school with what they're able to do at home. And so parents can learn.
Exactly.
With their child.
Ask their child to teach them some basic English.
Yes, and that can be quite fun.
Yeah.
Yes. Shall we move on to the next slide?
Yeah.
Okay. So, within the activity booklet, we've also got support for older and younger and older children. There is more. So we have options for parents' newsletters. Now, this is wonderful because it gives them plenty of ideas for them to explore topical things that are available. Also, we've got free interactive games that are available. For example, monkey puzzles, something that's very, very well received by parents. Mm. Now, can you tell us something more about that, Donya?
These are some really nice activities that students can do at home. So it's vocabulary, it's interactive. So again, parents can do it with their children, or they can do it on their own, or they could even do it in class.
Yes, exactly. Something that's very popular are the videos to sing along to. And I think this is something, well, lots of children like to sing, and as they're singing, they're learning vocabulary. Mm-hmm. And so I think this is something parents can enjoy with their child. Online learning activities. Now, these are more related to the older learners. So older learners can go into the website and they can select their level, select the language skill they want to practice, and explore the practice activities that we have available. So there's plenty there. It's not just about the younger learners. There's more there.
Can I just mention at this point, I'm getting lots of comments saying, oh, my students love monkey puzzles. I really like these activities. So that's really lovely to hear.
Yes, it's really nice. If there's something that you really like or that you've tried, it's important to signpost it so that we get an idea and other people feel motivated and want to try it. So thank you for that comment. Mm. Most welcome. So shall we move on? So we're going to take a look now at the presentation for parents. So you've gathered all your parents together. They're sitting there expectantly waiting for you to talk to them about Cambridge English qualifications. Now, I know that this can be quite worrying if you don't know what you're going to say, how you're going to say it, what can you say about Cambridge exams. Don't worry, follow the link to our page and you will find the presentation for parents. Now, you can see there, all you have to do is download the presentation. The heavy work has been done for you. Now, here we have the first pages of the presentation. And I've simply taken a screenshot which demonstrates what you're likely to see. Now, the presentation is designed to suit the purpose of the meeting. So it can be adapted. So you don't have to use every slide if that's not going to be relevant for your group. So let's move on to the next screen. Teaching and preparing.
Teaching and preparing, thank you. Okay, so we've looked at lots of great resources, ways to engage parents, so parents can support their children. Now, what about teaching and preparing? So in the classroom with the teachers. So again, let's follow the link to the website to teaching and preparing. Now, this will take you to teaching and preparing throughout the year. And if you scroll down, you'll find links to everything you need to get you up and running for teaching and preparing your learners for their Cambridge English qualification. Now, some of these resources include handbooks, resources for older learners, online games and activities, official exam preparation, as well as lesson plans. So at this stage, we'd really love to hear from you. Have you been on this part of our website before? Have you been on this part of our website before? Have you seen all of these resources? It'll be really interesting to know because, you know, there's so much available. So it'd be nice to know actually if you're aware of this or not. So there is a poll. Okay, we've got lots of you answering. Yes. So that's wonderful.
Ah, interesting results there because I can see that we've got just over 70% at the moment of you who have not been to the website before. Now, this is really interesting because I think this is your webinar. You're going to be able to find all these resources that you can explore after our webinar to help you prepare for the school, your learners for the examinations.
Exactly. It's wonderful that some of you have been on there before, and those of you that haven't, you're in for a treat.
Yes, they are.
Okay, so as you can see in bright red, I've highlighted lesson plans. So let's see where that takes us. This will take us to resources for teachers. Now, this is a resource finder and it's brilliant. Mm. So you can find the lesson plans or any resources by scrolling down and selecting from the drop-down boxes. So you'll see the top drop-down box says select qualification. So here you put in the exam that you're teaching. So for example, B1 preliminary, whichever exam it is that you're teaching, starters, movers, flyers. And then you can put in the CFR level, although if you've put in the exam, then that's not necessary. You'll still get the results that you're looking for. And then the next part, I have put lesson plan because that's what I'm after specifically. And then you can also select a skill. So if you know that you have a writing lesson or a speaking lesson and you just want to find it really quickly, you can be that specific in your search. If you just want to find all the lesson plans on one exam, then you don't need to put in the skill. Okay, so then when you click search, the list of lessons that are relating to that qualification will show up. So let's have a look at an example of a lesson plan. So I selected A2 flyers speaking. And then once the speaking lesson plans have come up, I've clearly chosen part two. And now, as you can see, this is an example of the lesson plan. It's really clearly laid out. You have your lesson aims, you have your materials that are required, and it tells you how long it will take in your lesson. So it's really, really simple for the teacher to download, print off, and take into their class. And it just means that you can be confident that the information that you're giving about the specific part of the exam is completely accurate. I mean, I'd say it's particularly useful for newer teachers who haven't taught the exams before and who maybe aren't as familiar with the format. And this will take them through. And we do have lesson plans for all of our exams, and they cover every single part of every single exam to really help students focus and understand how to do well in that part.
And indeed, that's also really helpful because it's going to help with the planning.
Exactly.
So it will reduce your planning time because you know precisely what to do. You've got a recipe to follow to help you with the lesson.
Exactly. Okay, so now we're going to go back to teaching and preparing throughout the year. And we're going to look for handbooks. Now, I've highlighted handbooks here because we all know that handbooks are absolutely vital for any teacher who is teaching an exam, aren't they?
Oh, essential.
They, you know, they cover everything. So it's all the information that you need about the exam, all the information about every part, example parts as well, and practice papers at the back. So they really guide the teacher through the exam and can be a really, really useful resource, okay? They really are packed with information. You know, some of you might have these printed out in your staff room, and that's brilliant. You've got a hard copy to have a look through. But if you don't know where it is, or you're in a rush, all you need to do is go to the website and click on the link, and it will take you to the digital version. I'd actually recommend using the digital version because you can be confident that it's the most up-to-date version.
Indeed.
And it does include links. And those links will take you to other parts of the website, or for example, they will take you to the audio for the listening if you're doing a listening part in the test, okay?
It's also helpful if you're at home, because you may be preparing for the next day and you quickly need to find out precisely what's expected. You can go straight in to the website and download it. So it's free for you to use.
Also good to save paper.
Yes, oh, indeed, of course.
All right. So, back to our resource finder. So we're looking for the handbooks. Now, remember when I showed you where you select lesson plans? This time, rather than selecting lesson plans, you select handbook for teachers, okay? And voila. So, on the left, this is the B2 First for Schools handbook. And then the one in the middle is the handbook for teachers for starters, movers and flyers. So those are our young learner exams. So one thing that I do need to point out to you at this point is if you're teaching A2 Key, A2 Key for Schools, B1 Preliminary and B1 Preliminary for Schools, you will know that these exams are being revised. And these revised exams are going to be used from January 2020. So don't worry, we have all the support that you need to help you with that transition, to explain all of the changes and give you all that support you need. But because those exams are not going to be used until January 2020, we've put all of this information on a separate site, okay? So it's a microsite, and I've shown you a picture here on the right of your screen of what that website looks like, and there's a link to it underneath. So the reason that we've kept it separate, because we don't want you to get confused. If some of you are still preparing for the current exams, some of you are preparing for the new exams, it's just clearer if they're in two separate places. But from January 2020, all of those new revised versions will be in the same place as the other exams. So by using that resource finder, it will take you to all of the up-to-date information from
January
2020. Okay, so now we've looked at teaching and preparing, what about registering for the exam?
Well, here we are. So you've encouraged your learners, you've been teaching your learners and preparing for the exam. And of course, parents are going to have to enter their child and register for the exam. But it's not always so straightforward for our parents. They may have a lot of questions. So how do we find out and give them information that they will need? So, as we say, go to the website and select register for the exam. And you know that there's going to be a lot of questions. The sorts of questions they may have will be, what happens on exam day? What happens after the exam? And is my child ready for the exam? So a lot of parents can feel quite anxious at this point, and they will also want extra tips to help their child prepare as they approach for the exam. So you will find all that you need in that part of the website. You will find a guide for talking to parents. Now, this is a really helpful thing for parents to look at, because you can have some ideas about what you're going to say, about how to guide them through the registration process, information about how to pay, for example, and those sorts of things. But there's also a letter to parents where you can put extra information that you may wish to clarify with your parents. After all, you know your parents well, so you can clarify there. Now, what about extra information for parents and candidates? Remember, they may be anxious, they may want to know how they can help their child as they reach the exam phase of the year. And this is a little tool that you can put in with your letter to parents to give them extra information with tips and ideas. Very reassuring, we find, isn't it? Now, further to that, and this is something I think that a lot of families and schools like, is that we have a candidate experience video, which you can show to parents and parents can look at home with their child. And here we have a student who's a young learner, and he's talking to his teacher and explaining what it was like and how he felt. Well, he looks quite happy there, Donya. So I think he enjoyed the experience, and clearly he was well prepared for the exam. But this is really reassuring for parents. But what about final preparation?
Okay. So we looked closely at how teachers can help their students prepare throughout the year and the resources we have available. But what about as we're approaching exam day and, you know, we're making our final preparations? Do we have anything that's more focused and really going to help our students get ready? So if we follow the links again from the website and we check our resources, you will find all you need for these final stages, okay? So some of the things we have here are speaking test videos, a really, really useful resource. So students can watch a whole speaking test and see what's going to happen, what do they have to do, what's the examiner going to ask, how are they going to interact, how long will it last? So it's really about taking out the unknown and the fear to ensure that they're feeling as confident and as prepared as they can. And that will mean that on the day, they can really focus on what they're saying and what they're doing and not worrying about what's going to happen next.
So no surprises.
No surprises. Which is really, really, really important, you know, in order for them to do as best that they can.
Yes.
We also have a writing checklist. Now, these checklists are for C1 and C2 levels. So those are our advanced and proficiency exams, because students at these levels are required to write a lot more extensively. And this writing checklist, again, is just a really useful resource. It's quite short and easy to look through. It has points of and tips that they need to remember and know how to do, and just a really useful checklist for them to be able to check that they're ready for the exam. Write and improve. Sorry, would you like
to? I was just about to mention about the writing checklist, actually.
Okay.
I think it's a really nice little tool. It's a PDF, and it can be downloaded and printed off. And in fact, in the run-up to the exams, they can tick off
exactly
what they've done, and they know what they need to work on. And that's a really helpful thing.
And speaking of working on their writing, write and improve. For those of you who haven't used it before, and I've seen from the comments that some of you have, which is lovely, it's a wonderful resource, and students can submit a piece of writing online and they get feedback almost straight away. And the feedback comments on the vocabulary that they've used, on their grammar structures, on their content. So students are able to look at that and see what they can do to make that piece of writing better. A really useful way of ensuring that they're improving their writing, because it can be tricky when you're practicing, not knowing how to actually get better. So a lovely resource that teachers really like as well, and students can do at home in their own time and submit as many pieces of writing as they like.
Yes.
and get the feedback quickly rather than having to wait for it to be marked.
Indeed.
Really lovely resource. And then we do have sample papers and practice tests. So again, this is a really nice way for students to ensure that they know what's coming, they know the exam format, they understand the rubric, so the instructions, because we have set tasks, so they know the tasks that are coming up for their specific papers. And with the practice test, you could set a mock test, so they could do the test in the same time that they would in the exam, again, to give them the feeling of doing the real test, so they're a bit more prepared and they can see how they're doing and maybe where they need to work a bit harder. And then we also have understanding assessment scales. Again, really useful for teachers and for students. So it's looking at the assessment scales, at where your students are going to be graded. So what kind of things are going to help them get a higher score, what they need to be able to do in terms of the skills and the language. And you can use these assessment scales when marking students' work and showing these assessment scales to your students and showing them whereabouts they are on these scales and what they could do to get higher marks. So really, really useful.
Yes, I think these are resources that are going to be really helpful for you to explore after the webinar. So you can really get in up, really look at them carefully and then understand more about how they work. But they really are super. And as you said, a number of people have commented on the write and improve.
They have, but I'd actually, at this point, it would be really, you know, great to hear from you. Which of these resources have you used? So we've heard some people have used write and improve.
Yes.
So which which other resources have you used? And if you haven't used them, which ones would you like to try? So which resources have you used and which would you like to try?
So type that into your text box and we'll take a look.
They are super duper.
Let's see.
Oh, so teachers here have said, yes, we use mock tests, very helpful for students.
Yes.
That's a really good point. I have used most of them. They are all very good.
That's very reassuring to hear. So thank you for that.
Some of you have said we haven't used Write and Improve, so we would like to try that.
Yes. Yeah, and that's interesting. If you haven't used it, if you look at the comments that have come in, they're all very positive about it. So that should inspire you to go away and perhaps give it a go.
Our speaking test videos are useful. They are. And somebody has just asked a question, actually, about those speaking test videos, saying, can we see the scores? And that's actually a really good question.
Yeah.
Yes, you can. So with all of the speaking test videos, there are also documents that go with those videos, which have a transcript of what the students have said and what they have scored for those speaking answers. So as a teacher, that is so, I mean, it's invaluable, isn't it, to be able to look at that and say, okay, this student's got that score, how are my students doing and how do they compare to that?
Yes.
So that's really useful.
And it will also help you to grade your learners based on the criteria by looking at that as an example. So that could be your model for your own speaking tests.
And many people would say, I would like to try all of them.
Good.
And good. We recommend
that.
Do. We recommend that you do try all of them.
Yes.
Maybe not all at the same time.
No, that would be very confusing.
Okay, so here's just a summary of the resources that we've talked about. Okay. Okay, so we've prepared for the exam. We've done the final preparation. We've taken the exam. What about the results?
Okay, so here we go. So the students have done really, really well. The teachers have done really, really well in preparing their learners. And the exam has been taken. So we're here to help. We don't just talk about the preparation of the exam. We want to talk about exam results and understanding results as well. Again, follow the link from the website. There's a link there to exam results. And this takes you through to a screen which provides you with a really helpful video with information that explains the statement of results. So follow the video, that's really, really helpful, especially for you if you're talking to learners about what's going to happen after the exam. There will be something about what's on the certificate. Now, there's a lot of information on the certificate. It's really a very rich document with a lot of information for you. There's information about can they get results online? And also, for the learners who are taking the higher level exams, how can institutions verify my results? Now, that information is given on the website, it's given through the video, so you can explore that at your leisure. Now, we don't have time to go through those in detail, do we, Donya? Because we're giving you an overview of what's there for you to go away and explore for yourselves.
But now you know where to do that exploring.
Exactly.
So you can, in your own time, have a look through all of it, you know, and get a good understanding.
A better idea. Good. So, they've all passed their exams and it's time to celebrate. All that hard work has come to fruition. Everyone's really happy. And this is a really excellent time of the year.
It is, because as Miranda said, it's not just focusing on the exam. It's about looking at the whole journey, the whole learning journey.
Yes.
Because that's what's important, isn't it? It's the learning.
Definitely.
So it is really an event that can be celebrated and made very, very special. So we provide you with the tools to help you do this, okay? So one thing that you could do to celebrate your success is hold a certificate ceremony. Such a lovely idea. And, you know, the chance for students to feel really proud of their achievement, being presented with a certificate, a Cambridge certificate, by their teacher or by their head teacher. Now, you might think that sounds like a lot of organising to do, but we're here for you and we have everything that you need. So again, if you follow that link from the website, you can find everything you need here for learners, teachers and parents to celebrate the achievements from the guide, okay? So, certificate ceremony, guide to celebrating success, and we also have posters. So the invitation you can download and print and send out to parents, which again I think makes it feel like an occasion rather than just saying, oh, tell your parents to come to this.
Yes, exactly.
It feels like a real event, and it, for parents it feels like, oh, this is important, it's been organised, it's been really thought through, which does make it feel more special. We have the ceremony poster, which you can display around your centres so people are aware that these events are happening. And I think that can be quite motivating for those who aren't taking the exams to see, oh, people who have had exams and they have a ceremony. I think it's nice to be aware of what's going on in your school.
I also think it's a really nice moment for learners to celebrate their success of what they've done, but also to think about where they might go next in terms of taking other exams. So they've got one. Where do we go next? What's our next exam that we can prepare for? We want to learn more. So this is a really lovely way of motivating and helping parents to think, yes, my child's doing well. There's more to learn.
Exactly, there's always more to learn.
Yes.
So we also have the thank you letters for teachers, which, you know, that the head teacher or the director of studies might like to make use of to give out to their teachers, or parents could take them to give to their teachers.
And it's an acknowledgement of how hard teachers have worked to prepare their learners, isn't
it? And now here we've got a picture for you of a video. We're not going to play it, but we recommend that you watch it again in your own time. So the school can use this at their certificate ceremony, which parents and learners can enjoy and, you know, feel proud of their achievements. So really it's a congratulations from Cambridge to say well done on what you've achieved and good luck in your next step.
On your learning journey.
On your learning journey. Okay.
Okay, so what else do we have? You'll notice from the website that there's a section called Information and News. And I want to take a closer look at that right now. So if you look at the website, follow the link, you will see that you can pick up the latest news for schools by signing up for our newsletters. Now, the newsletters are really, really an excellent way to stay in touch with one another. So we are able to share expertise, offer tips and advice and information about how you can support your learners. So the kinds of topics, this is just an example of a few that we cover, are things like ELT, teaching English as a career. What are your options? What professional development? It explores things like blended learning. Now, this is something we hear an awful lot about, but putting it into practice, it's helpful to have some tips and ideas about how to integrate technology meaningfully into your classroom. On the same note, it's also a nice idea to be able to learn to use video in the classroom. And topics like this are covered in the newsletters because it may inspire you to try something that you haven't tried before, but it will just give you a few ideas for you as teachers to decide how you'd like to approach this, if you'd like to try it. Tips for teaching and also the value for our learners of learning those four language skills. All of these are covered in a different way with different topics in our newsletters. So, we have reached the end of our presentation, and I'm wondering what questions we might have from our gathered group.
We already have some questions, but if you have any more now, please do type them in and we will try to answer as many as we can. An interesting question, somebody said, wonderful website, do we have to pay for this? And the answer is no, you don't have to pay for this. No. So as we've already said, you will be sent these slides after the webinar is over, and go to the links within the presentation, which will take you to our website, and it's completely free.
Yes, so explore. That's the tip from myself and Donya.
Yes. Okay. We had a question, Miranda. Will first certificate exams be revised in 2020?
Now, we need to come back to you on that. As far as I'm aware, that's
2020? No. January 2020
Okay, fine.
Is only... don't worry.
Oh, that was a shock for me.
is only the A2 key and B1 okay. preliminary, okay? And the fiscals version.
Yes. And there's a lot of work going on for that at the moment. So everything's going to be ready for you to go with the key and preliminary in January. But B2 first remains as is. So don't worry. No need to worry.
Yeah. And talking about those revised exams, somebody also said, are there resources for those? So as I explained before, there are resources and they are on the microsite. And there is a link to that microsite.
Yes.
In the presentation, okay?
It's really important that you follow that link to the microsite, because that will take you directly through to information and support for you as teaching for the revised exams.
And we do have sample papers on that site, because that's another question that's come up many times. Are there sample papers? Yes, there are sample papers. So you can look at those right now on the microsite. Okay, let's have a look at some other questions.
Any recommendations? There's a nice one there, but what advice do you have for talking to parents of students? You've moved it up, actually.
Oh, sorry. Who did not pass.
Okay, for students who didn't pass, I think it's a question of celebrating their success. What can they do? And think about where they're going forward and the next steps for learning English. It's not a question about pass or fail. Not necessarily, not always. It's about they've learned English. They've practiced and prepared for the exam. They have learned. But it's not the end of, it's not the end of their learning journey if they haven't passed. So I think it's a question of how you talk and share that information with learners, and of course you'll be aware of what they can do by following and knowing what their strengths and what their weaknesses are, and think about things that they can work on for the next time.
And just to add to that, Miranda showed you where on the website you can watch the video explaining your statement of results, and it explains all about the results. So you'll see that when they get their statement of results, it will tell them their level.
Yeah.
So if they take an A2 exam and they're below the level, it will tell them that their level is A1. So it's not necessarily you've failed and you can't speak English. This is your level, okay? And then from there, you can take steps to improve to get to the next level.
Yes, and plan ahead.
Yes,
look forward.
But it is important to keep encouraging students and, you know, ensuring that they're motivated and that they want to continue. So, you know, none of this, you've done really badly. It's all about positivity and encouragement.
Yes, yes, it is indeed.
This is a good question. How often should mock tests be run? Interesting.
This is where we'd really like to be able to talk to you face to face, but it's a bit difficult to do that through a webinar. But how often should they be used? Now, it depends on how you're preparing your learners. Now, I think it's a really nice thing to do to practice sections of a test through the year. Mm. So sample tasks, but to perhaps run the mock test while they've been doing the preparation in the run-up towards the exam. So perhaps it has to be kept for the practice in the final preparation. And then you can work with your learners to identify where their strengths and where their weaknesses are. So I would recommend that be done in the final stages, in the final preparation. What are your thoughts, Donya?
Yeah, it's an interesting one because I think it's so important to practice the test and also to do it in
conditions.
In conditions.
Yes.
But also you don't want the focus of the exam to, you don't want the whole focus of the year to be, you've got an exam, you've got an
yes.
exam, you've got an exam.
Exactly.
So you want the focus to be on the learning and developing skills
yes.
and language
yes.
rather than practicing the exam throughout the year. So I think what
yes.
you said about, you know, looking at each part and taking it apart throughout the year as you develop certain
yes.
skills and you focus on
yes.
different parts of the exam.
Yeah.
And then perhaps nearer the end, when you've covered everything, doing a mock test.
Yes. So it's a bit like putting all the pieces of the puzzle together. So practice through the year, take apart the different task types, and then focus on the exam at the end. It's a real concern. I agree with you, Donna. I think it makes students think that it is all about teaching to the test.
Yeah.
And we're not about that. It's about working towards success and working towards learning English
yeah.
and that the exam, you will have done all the preparation beforehand, so the exam comes as a natural way of concluding the year. But use the mocks at the, towards the end of the year.
Okay, I'm just having a few more looks through these questions. Somebody has said, where after the webinar, how can other people access it who haven't watched it? So in terms of sharing with your colleagues, that's a great question.
Yes.
All of our past webinars are on YouTube, aren't they?
Yes, they are. Yeah.
So
you can locate them.
You can locate them. So any that you've missed, you can go to YouTube and you can find all of our webinars.
Yes.
And there's lots there. So any free time you have, or if you're looking into professional development for the year, you can have a look through, look
yes.
at the topics that have been covered and choose which ones to watch in your own time.
Exactly. I would agree with that. I think... when are we having the new material for 2020 exams?
Okay, so we've had a few of these questions already. So like I said, please look on the microsite, and there is a link to that within this presentation. And the microsite contains sample papers, an explanation of the changes.
Lesson plans?
The lesson plans will be up there.
They're on their way.
In mid-October.
Yes, we're not ready yet, so be patient.
There
They're coming.
There are some beautiful posters with classroom activities. There are short videos about all the different tasks, so things that are really helpful for teachers and lovely to show your students. All the information that you need to start the year is on that microsite, so have a look and tell all your colleagues about it as well. Okay.
Should we take one more question? Let's have a look. When are we having it? So
I think we've covered
Not sure if I...
No.
Will you send the slides? Yes, we will. Don't worry about that. Parents often ask, that's an interesting one. So I've seen somebody comment about parents often ask how they can help their child at home. Well, I think this is a really wonderful opportunity for you to go into the website and to take a look at the sorts of tips and ideas that they can help their child with at home.
Exactly.
So I think that would take us back to the start of our presentation when we looked at practice tips for activity booklets with parents.
Yeah. Oh, and one final question, just because it's popped up and I think it's a good one,
yeah.
is somebody has said, what about resources for weaker students? So if you remember back to the resource finder that I talked you through,
yes.
where you can put in the exam that you're teaching or the level and what resource you're looking for, if you're not teaching a particular exam or you think that your students are a lower level, rather than putting in the exam, just put in the CFR level. So put
yeah.
in the level that you need materials for, and all of the materials for those levels will come up.
Yes.
So whether you have a particularly weaker students or stronger students, everything you need will be there.
Yes.
Okay.
And of course, you can select the skill that they're going to need to practice.
Exactly.
So if they need practice on their writing and they're slightly weak on that, go in with the writing or the speaking. So select the skill and perhaps adapt the level that's appropriate for that learner, so they feel they're successful, not failing. So that was our last question?
It was, yeah,
okay.
It was.
So without further ado, thank you so much for your time. It's been really a great pleasure to have you join us with us today.
It has, and we hope that you found it useful and that you're going to go away now and spend the whole day and evening looking through our website and finding everything you need to help you plan the year ahead. So
yes.
Best of luck and thank you.
And good luck for the year. Goodbye.